the citric acid cycle. It's also called the Krebs cycle. It was proposed in 1937 by Hans Krebs, and he received the Nobel Prize 16 years later in 1953. Consists of 8 reactions that were deciphered, starting materials and products. And how he did it in those years, I'll never know. These days, it would be a lot easier with the instrumentation that we have. You can look at those 8 reactions within the text. We don't care that we certainly don't want you to memorize the cycle. What we'd like you to know is the purpose of the cycle and maybe the summary features. And the purpose is to form FADH2 and NADH. FAD and NAD are hydrogen transporters. They take these hydrogen atoms to the electron transport chain, where ultimately they'll combine with the oxygen that we breathe to form water. This is a very energetic process, gives off lots of energy, and this is where we get most of our energy from foods. And the real purpose of foodstuffs is to supply hydrogen. And that hydrogen combining with the oxygen to form water. Let's look at the carbons that are involved in the citric acid cycle. The fuel for the citric acid cycle is acetyl-CoA. It's a 2-carbon unit that comes into the citric acid cycle reacting with the C4 to form C6, and then a series of reactions takes place, ultimately coming back to the starting point, and in the process giving off 2 molecules of CO2. So when we eat food, the carbons are ultimately going to be breathed out as molecules of CO2 gas, and the hydrogen atoms, as you know, are what we're really grabbing a hold of so that we can get the energy from those. In terms of summary features, there are 5 points that I'd like you to know. Number 1, we've just mentioned that acetyl-CoA is the fuel. When glycolysis occurs, it forms pyruvic acid. Pyruvic acid can permeate the membrane of the mitochondria. Once inside the mitochondria, it forms acetyl-CoA, and then acetyl-CoA enters the citric acid cycle. The cycle depends upon a supply of NAD+ and FAD, the 2 hydrogen transporters. They can't pick up hydrogen if we don't have these molecules coming and loading up that hydrogen. The electron transport chain is oxygen dependent. That means that if we're not breathing and we're not taking oxygen into the bloodstream, being distributed to the cells, the electron transport chain can't work, and supplies of NAD+ and FAD can't work their way back to the electron to the citric acid cycle. So if you stop breathing, there's no oxygen, the electron transport chain stops, and then the citric acid cycle stops too, and the lights go out. Number 3, that the carbons leave as molecules of CO2. The 2 hydrogen transporters, there are 3 molecules of NADH that are formed and 1 FADH2. These numbers are important because in the next step, when we get to the electron transport chain, we'll tabulate how many molecules of ATP are available. And then the 5th, in this process, a GTP is formed. Simply a different base here than A. The base G, and so it's really, we count as the equivalent of 1 ATP. Let's look at the regulation of the cycle. Energy regulation is very important to the body, so the body closely regulates the citric acid cycle. And there are 3 points at which it does this, and perhaps the most important would be the entry point into the citric acid cycle, where the C4 oxaloacetate reacts with acetyl-CoA to form the C6 citrate. The enzyme that is involved is called citrate synthetase. And citrate synthetase is an allosteric enzyme. We talked about allosteric enzymes back in the enzyme chapter. These are enzymes that can be affected by relatively small molecules that can alter their structure perhaps in subtle ways to either make the enzyme more efficient or to inhibit the enzyme. These small molecules that have that effect are called modulators. ATP and NADH both inhibit the allosteric enzyme citrate synthetase. Well, what's the meaning of that? If we have lots of energy, our supplies of ATP are high, and these hydrogen transporters are high, carrying those hydrogen atoms to the electron transport chain. In other words, if these supplies are high, we don't need energy production to be maximum, and so they slow down citrate synthetase. On the other hand, citrate synthetase is activated by ADP. Well, when ATP is used by the body to supply energy, it gives rise to ADP. So ADP level indicates how much energy is needed. And if the enzyme is activated by ADP, it's trying to turn on the citric acid cycle and produce more energy. Steps 3 and 4 regulate enzymes at those positions in sort of the same way. They're inhibitors, NADH, energy is high, so we don't need the citric acid cycle to work as efficiently, and it's activated again by ADP. Step 4, inhibited by NADH and ATP. Again, if energy levels are high, we don't need the citric acid cycle to be working at its maximum, so it slows down. Very interesting how the body controls these processes, and it does through allosteric enzymes.